Christmas Day, and we were off in the wake of the dog teams. Of our load, 22 tons was petrol. We were carrying our depots with us. We were 8 vehicles leaving South Ice, and it was planned that we would reach Scott Base with only 4. As the fuel was burnt, the weakest vehicles would be left behind. Only by these tactics could we get across. South Ice was to let now.
For Hillary, with tractors never designed for work at high altitudes, fuel consumption was now running alarmingly high. Everything superfluous jettisoned, he was pushing on the last 100 miles to the pole with 3 tractors and only 1 loaded sledge. January the 4th, 1958, with fuel for only another 20 miles, he was there. The first to make the journey overland since Captain Scott in 1912. A welcome and congratulations from the Americans at their polar station, established by air for the International Geophysical Year. Hillary radioed to Fuchs. "I'm concerned about serious delay in your plans. You have major journey in front of you to reach pole and 1,250 more miles to Scott Base in deteriorating weather. Why not fly out from pole and return next year to complete journey?" To this, Fuchs replied, "Appreciate your concern, but there can be no question of abandoning journey." Yet still, there was no easy passage for the snowcats. For now, the way ahead was strewn with enormous fields of sastrugi, rock-hard ice dunes forming a frozen, choppy sea that reduced their speed yet again to a snail's crawl. This terrain played havoc with the tracks and steering, and made repairs a continual necessity in 50 degrees of frost. Nonetheless, the scientific program was faithfully maintained. On the 59th day of their journey, with the going easier at last, 2 events spurred the party. They learned that their expedition plane had reached Scott Base. The RAF party had made this non-stop pioneering flight from South Ice via the pole with a long-range tank that allowed them only 1 hour's reserve of fuel. There were congratulations to John Lewis, Gordon Haslop, Peter Weston and Taffy Williams for their great achievement. Back in the endless expanse of snow, Fuchs and his navigator checked their positions. And from the top of a snow ridge they saw, at long last, some black dots on the horizon which marked the South Pole. They had caught up with their dog teams by now. Together they made the final run in. From the Ross Sea, 3 great travellers, Amundsen, Scott and Hillary, had reached the South Pole. Now, Fuchs had pioneered the way from the Weddell Sea, the unknown side. Scott Base, representatives of the world's press were flown up by the Americans to meet the party. Alongside Fuchs, as host of the conference, was Admiral Dufek, commander of the United States Polar Activities. Question: why go on with so little time in hand, and having already made this historic journey? Question: with winter fast encroaching, would he still risk it? Fuchs replied, there has never been any doubt. For Fuchs, there was no doubt that the traverse to the other side must be carried through to make the journey scientifically complete. It was their 63rd day, and there were still 1,250 miles to go. But now there was the great advantage of traveling a known path. Dangerous and time-consuming crevasse areas could be avoided by following Hillary's inland route. And there were the well-marked successive depots of fuel that he had established for Fuchs and his party for this second stage of their crossing. It had always been planned that the two would meet at the most southerly depot. Hillary flew in, and together they traveled the last 700 miles. February the 21st, 1958. The first sight of mountains for 1,500 miles. The end of an epic trek was in sight. Taken 99 days, one day less than Fuchs had estimated when first he planned this crossing. With his companions, he headed the caravan of snowcats north for the last 25 miles. Of polar exploration in the tradition of Amundsen, Scott, and Shackleton. Scott Base and the other side of Antarctica. Men of our century, with a vision and a spirit of adventure to rank them with the great explorers of history. 12 men had crossed and learned a little more about the last unknown continent on Earth.